Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? Did he give you a royal escort out of his forest? What happened? I want to hear about it. So does everyone else. So send all the details in an email to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I'll narrate your story and then everyone can share. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone, and thanks for stopping in to hang out with me. It's always good to have some company. Now, tonight, we have a return submitter. We know her as Midget Queen. Now, Midget Queen, or Catherine, as her name is, well, she has some interesting insights and observations from her many years of, well, I guess you would call it a friendship with a whole family of Bigfoots. So, make sure you got your drink and your snackage. Let's get saddled up. We got to head on out and move on down into Sasquatch Valley for tonight's encounter. Greetings, Nance. This is Catherine again. This could be lengthy. It has been a while since I wrote to you, so this is a catch-up. I hope you will enjoy and share it with others. My experience is not professional, and I will never try to sound as if I am all-knowing, but my experience is face-to-face, and it lasted about 3 years or so while in the Ocala National Forest between 12 and 17. I am now 68. I have always been a logical realist. Additionally, I have a rich family history among my artistic genres. I am also a genealogist, and I have traced one of my family lines back to around 42. And folks, she wrote it as 042/100, so I think she means the year 42, but I'm not sure. So Catherine, if I'm wrong, please correct me. I am Scottish, English, Irish, Swedish, Norse, Cherokee, and Algonquin. I have been gifted with abilities handed down through Mother Bear and other ancestors to ascertain things that many people are not always aware of and or are seen by others, and to converse when they feel it is important to share their knowledge. I assume this has made it easier to communicate with the Sasquatch, the ones that befriended me in the Ocala National Forest. So here we go. The Ocala National Forest is a beautiful, lush area, and we lived on 69 acres of it, which the back of the property bordered the Ocklawaha River. Now, the river was full of many kinds of life forms, from gators to frogs to raccoon to armadillos and many types of fish, plenty for the Sasquatch to eat, plus the deer and other animals that populated the area, which is why I think they never bothered my chickens or other pets. Like I said, I spent a lot of time in the forest, and at least 2 to 4 evenings a week with Sasquatch as my company. They appeared to be a family, or an extended family. Actually, it took about a year before I could get fairly close to them. There was the big guy, as I called him. He was at least 8 to 9 feet, with various shades of brown hair and darker down the middle of his back and long in places and not so long in others. He was almost always clean-looking, except for pieces of leaves and some debris hanging off in places from walking in the forest, and he had dirty feet. He had this weightlifter kind of body that would have put Schwarzenegger to shame, and at least 4 feet across the shoulders. He had deep-set amber-colored eyes that seemed almost hidden by the well-defined eyebrow ridge. His face was leathery, with a broad nose and a wide, small-lipped smile. He was attentive to his whole family, especially Mama, to whom he obviously cared a great deal for, and he did not seem to mind when the little ones ran around his legs. He really liked apples and bananas, and in particular, nuts, and the occasional cookie. His face, as well as the face of all the others, they were very human-like, with deep-set eyes that were spaced fairly far apart. But considering the width of the bridge of the nose, that would be expected. He had dark-colored amber eyes with an obvious sclera visible, though Mama, her eyes were pretty and hazel-like. The big guy had a beard that hung long from his chin, with what could be called mustache hair coming from just above the upper corner of his lips, and it hung down with his beard, which was at least 6 to 8 inches long. The nose was fairly flat, but on the mother, she had a bony point, so it gave her a little more of an attitude. The big guy was obviously the dominant one, though I never saw him treat his family unkind. But they all deferred to him with respect. He had a few sounds that were like a sharp bark, and he would make them to indicate that it was time to go or the kids needed to settle down. But they always listened, and they went or they left just like that. The skin on their faces was sort of leathery, but soft-looking, especially on the children and the two females. Their mouths were fairly straight across, but not all the way to the ears. They were pretty human-like, actually. There was a slight fullness to the bottom lip in particular, and more so on the two females, and they had straight, dingy white to yellow teeth with slightly emphasized canines. Their ears were not very big, and they laid close to the head. They had no hair on the surface. There was also the old man, as I called him. He had dark to various shades of thinning gray hair that had a shaggy and sparse look to it, and perhaps even a silvery look to it across his face and shoulders, and dark gray down his back. He seemed to have some areas of baldness, like the top of his head and parts of his upper arms and thighs. He did not mingle much, at least till we all became more friendly. He showed aging signs, such as a wrinkled face and hands. I also noticed he kind of limped when he walked, and he had missing teeth. The big guy, he was respectful of the old man. But the old man, he was always watching, and he seemed not to miss anything. The four kids were, and since I have no idea how they age, I just guessed their age to height like human kids. So I guesstimated that the kids were about 6 and 8 years, and the older one to be about mid-teens or older. And the female, she might have been in her young 20s. Now, I was 4 feet 11 inches tall in those days, and the littlest one was about to my shoulder, and the other one was about my height. The little ones were sort of a blondish-brown hair color, and they were both boys. They wrestled with each other and played together with the things natural to their environment. But they loved the ball that I gave them. I showed them how to play with it, and we sometimes played together. They also loved bubbles. Then there was the two females. The mother I referred to as Mama, and she was companion to the big guy. She was about 7 feet tall, I think. She was large-breasted, with dark, leathery areolas, and had a soft, leathery face and soft, leathery hands. Her reddish-brown hair was long around her face and was the longest of all of them. It looked like she tried to keep it clean, minus the forest debris. Her face was not quite as flat as the others, and she had little to no hair on her face or breasts, and she had very little on her hands. She seemed more human-like, and she was very friendly. Mama was very attentive to the two little ones, and I noticed that she had fashioned a few toys made from sticks and fabric for them to play with, and they behaved better than some human kids I have known. I also enjoyed the relationship between Mama and the big guy. It was so sweet. It was obvious the way they treated each other. There was some form of affection. The older teenage male was the proverbial awkward teen. He had the shortest hair, and it was dark brown. He also was well built and well muscled, and he had the widest nose of all. He was about 7 or 8 feet tall. Goofy seemed to hang with the big guy. I figured he was the brother or friend to the big guy. He was nearly as tall as the big guy, with the darkest hair of them all, and he was built like a linebacker. But he had longer legs than the rest. I called him Goofy because he walked like the Disney character, but with amazingly long strides. He was also always on the lookout. If there was a noise in the forest, he would amble off to go check it out. He was restless and was always wandering about. The other female, I called her Rose. She looked to be young, but not as young as a teen. For a Sasquatch? Well, she was as pretty as a Sasquatch could be. She was about 6 feet and had notable breasts, and while built strongly, she was more feminine. She was always picking at her fingernails. Her hair was like a reddish-brown blonde, depending on the sunlight. She was pretty quiet, too. I also noticed she had a habit of making this humming sound to herself. Now, I will interject here, and I will tell you that my dad had the prettiest whistle. There was this musical vibrato, and he frequently whistled when he walked in the forest or was out shopping. And this was sometimes how we found him out in the stores, and he would do it also when we got separated so I could find him. Some months into our residence there, before the Sasquatch had made themselves known to me, I heard Dad's distinctive whistle one evening coming from the forest. But Dad, he was sitting there watching TV in the living room. I was like, what the heck? I learned they love to mimic human behaviors and human sounds and other animal sounds. And they do it so very well. It was also during this time that I found the structure and the broken trees and branches all along the river's edge, and then I put two and two together. A few days later, after locating the structure, the dogs were making a fuss and they were charging the forest edge, and that's when I saw them just behind the tree line. They were swaying and watching. I frequently referred to them as the watchers, because they watch us and learn. Now, this went on for some weeks, perhaps even months. Finally, I just walked out towards the tree line and I said, "Hello, I can see you, so stop hiding." They backed off and disappeared. But they were right back the next night. And again, I went out there and I spoke to them. I said, "I'm not going anywhere, so you might as well come out." A few nights later, they came back, so I went out, and I sat on the tree stump about 8 feet away from them, and I started singing and talking to them. They made some clicking sounds, and they chattered to each other. That is when I realized some of the sounds that I had been hearing while out in the forest were them. They were communicating with each other. There was what I called the chipmunk chatter. It sounds kind of like chattering of chipmunks, but it also reminded me a little of the Cherokee native language and other native or First Nations people's languages. There were some similarities. Then I also became aware of the other sound that they made, which was the sound that you hear from bats. It's called echolocation. This was very sophisticated, and I found it most fascinating. The clicking sound, it was sort of like the clicking or clucking of your tongue. Well, they were making this sound one day, and then I made it too. There was total silence. They all stood and just stared at me with a look of shock. I don't think they expected me to copy them. As time went by, I would sometimes do it while out walking in the forest. and then I would hear them in the distance, answering me back. It was comforting to have them around. I know this is long, but I still want to share something else with you. At this time in my life, I had waist-length hair. It was a hassle to dry, and I would sometimes sit outside on the stump near the back door and comb out my hair in the sun to dry it. I noticed one late afternoon when I was home alone, the female seemed very interested in what I was doing. So I went into the house, and I found a denim bag that I had made that had a long strap that went across the chest. I put two sturdy combs in it and a round mirror that was in a pink plastic frame. I went out and I showed everything to them. I took out one of the combs and I combed my hair. Then I put the comb back in the bag and then took out the mirror. I looked into it to show them what to do with it. This really shook them up. It was funny, this whole mirror thing. I guess you just had to see them, but it kind of scared them at first. I also put the bag strap around my neck, and I showed them how to use it. But the strap, it really was not long enough for them to use. I then walked closer to the tree line, and I noticed they did not back away. Rose was standing behind Mama. I held out the bag in hopes that Mama would come forward to take it from me. And she did after a long pause. I was like, holy cow! She took it straight from my hand. I gave her a big smile, and she attempted to smile back. They both look happy. She stepped back some and then took out a comb. She copied me and combed her hair. I motioned for her to give the other comb to Rose, and she did. They both acted like they were excited schoolgirls. They were chattering back and forth and looking at me comb my hair, and they both copied me. I had also put a bar of lavender fragrant soap in the bag, but I don't think she knew what to do with it. But she did like the smell. But what was really unexpected, and not only surprised me, but really caught me off guard, was that as I started to comb my hair again with my comb, I would hold out the length of my hair to comb it. Mama came over and tentatively reached out to touch my hair. I was like, oh my goodness. Then she made this sound that made me think she went, ooh, and then kind of laughed. And then she softly did it again. She then turned to Rose and she made this chipmunk-like sound, just chittering and talking to Rose. And then she turned to me and she said in mind speak what sounded to me like pretty. I thanked her and I reached out to her. She touched my hand. Her hand was leathery. The underside was a dark salmon color with dark lines, and it was softer than I expected. The hair on top of her hand was fairly soft as well. She then seemed to get nervous and reached out to Rose, and they scuttled back into the tree line. Just before they disappeared into its depths, she turned to look at me, and she raised her hand as she had seen me do many times to wave. I waved back, and they were gone. Here's another story about my Sasquatch family. One evening, when I was sitting on the car and they were at the tree line watching, a huge Bigfoot appeared suddenly in the road about 30 feet from the family and me. He had red eyes, and he was at least 10 feet tall. He was covered in dark brown and black hair, and he was massively built. The family saw him, and the big guy, he barked a bark that I had never heard before. He was clearly alarmed. He had barked anxiously to his family, and then he turned to growl and scream at the massive Bigfoot that had appeared. The big guy also turned to me, and in mind speak, he told me to run home. And then they, the whole family, ran. As I ran towards the house, I heard them keep telling me to run. He's bad. Run. So I did. I ran into the house, and I got my gun. He walked towards our house, and I stood at the window with that gun. The Bigfoot did not move, and he must have stood there at least half an hour, and he was sometimes growling at me, and then he would shriek out this hair-raising, body-vibrating, screaming screech sound. It pierced the whole night. So while he was there, no more than 12 feet from my kitchen window, and while all my outside animals were there but hidden, I remained at that window with the gun. As long as he was there, so was I. He then turned and made a few steps away back down the road, and then he just vanished. When I saw the Sasquatch family again a week later, the big guy told me that one kills humans, especially humans who have friends like them. He told me that he would always keep watch. I know that many people only see them as monsters and wild, dangerous animals, and perhaps there are some here and there that might and do fit those descriptions. But I dare say, and I challenge any person to define all Bigfoot or Sasquatch in that manner. History and many personal accounts would agree with me that not all Bigfoot or Sasquatch fit into the monster category. Let's face it, not all humans do either. Throughout history, there was and are humans that fall into the monster category. But not every human is bad, just like not every Bigfoot or Sasquatch is either. From all the stories over my lifetime and my own personal accounts, I can state with certainty that just like humans, Bigfoot and Sasquatch come in various sizes, colors, temperaments, and personalities. While it does annoy me when people refer to them as apes or gorillas, none of the ones I have witnessed would fall into those parameters. Their faces all look human. They communicate with each other with human-like, intelligent mannerisms, and many have manifested behavior traits that demonstrate kindness and concern for their own kind and for humans. But I understand that ignorance for what is unknown and for trying to figure out what one actually is seeing, it can easily be confused with the closest possible hairy animal. Here's another story. They all loved nuts. I learned that after giving them a few just here and there. My dad used to get this huge bushel basket full of nuts. It had lots of walnuts, Brazil nuts, and almonds. And I would always take some and put some in a brown bag. On the bag, I had drawn and colored a big red heart. I would leave it for them on the tree stump. After the second time of doing this, they left me a bunch of rocks with a heart drawn in the dirt right in front of the stump. Apparently, they watched me look for and collect rocks all along the riverbed in the forest. So, we gifted each other something we both liked. I frequently shared food with them and loved it the time that I gave them all popsicles on a hot summer day. They loved them, and it was fun to watch them eat them. I laughed so hard. I have one more story. I'll call it The Predator Bigfoot. Walking towards the river from my house, down perhaps a football field from home, was an area to the right that I loved to hang out at. There was this huge hickory tree, and I loved it. It set back off the road about 20 feet. I learned early on that about 20 feet behind this tree was a magical area. There was an area of the forest that was unlike any place I had ever been. There was a perfect circle of trees with densely packed forest on the outside. The grass inside this circle was the softest grass I had ever seen. It never had weeds, and it was this dark emerald green color. But what was really unusual is there was no bugs there. And the light from the sun, it was a shimmering bright sunlight. And as you walked from the regular forest into this circle, there was a difference in the way it all felt. It was almost as if you walked into a vacuum, and not all of my animals would follow me into this circle. There was this magical feeling there, and sometimes, even though I could see the whole space within the circle, sometimes it felt as if I were not alone, though I never felt fear there. In fact, I felt as if this circle was a place of safe refuge. There was this one time a guy that I had been trying to avoid came to visit. And considering how bad the directions were that I gave him, I was surprised he made it. I was lying in the grass there reading a book when he arrived. My mom told him where to find me. When he showed up out there, I was really not happy to see him. But we sat and we talked for a few minutes. Then he got amorous. I tried to back away, but he pushed me back onto the ground, and he started to get physically violent with me. I was laying on my back, and he was on top of me, holding my arms down. And all of a sudden, out of my peripheral vision to the right, I was aware of a disturbance. There was a shiny circle of light. I was then aware of something moving towards me. Something came down from that circle, and it came towards us. And then suddenly, that guy was literally airborne, and he landed about 5 feet away with a hard thud. It was as if someone had kicked him. I saw this shimmering, refracted light outline of a massive being. It moved towards my feet, and at first, I was terrified that I would be next. But then I was assured that I was no longer in harm's way. Then there was a rush of electrical-infused sound that blasted towards that guy, and it seemed to roll him over. Then that guy got up, stumbled. He was all pissed off, but even more, he was scared. He uttered some choice words. Then he ran away, falling all over himself. But he ran out of the circle, ran all the way back to his car, and left. I turned towards this shimmering apparition as I got up, and the being just went through a portal, and then he was gone with a crackling of sounds leaving the air all energized. I remember, when I first saw the Predator movie, that this was exactly like what I saw, and it kind of freaked me out. I have never forgotten that, and I never will. Well, I could go on, but I better stop. I have other stories I can share. Just let me know if you want to hear them. No worries about sharing my name. I'm not concerned with the negative opinion of others. It changes not my opinions, feelings, or experiences. I just want to say, my husband and I listen to you often. Thank you. Signed, your friend, Catherine, the Midget Queen. Well, Midget Queen, I think it goes without saying, I know I want to hear any other stories you have, and I'm going to bet a lot of the Sasquad that's listened tonight, probably 99% of them, want to hear it too. So be sure to send those in. We're always interested in these types of interactions that are a little more personal and some real insight and observation. So be sure to send those on in. All right, everyone. Well, we're going to wrap it up here tonight. I'm just going to put out once again because I've gotten a few already. I'm still looking for submissions for Halloween. I will take some fiction as long as it is clearly marked fiction. They will be in a separate marathon on Halloween. But I'm also looking for some extra scary Bigfoot stories or encounters. Just even something that maybe happened on a dark night out there in the forest. Something that would be great to listen to on Halloween night as you sit there with all those Reese cups lined up like chocolate shots all along the armchair. Just after Halloween trick-or-treat, something great to listen to. So be sure to send them in and be sure to put Halloween in the subject line. All right, everyone. Again, thanks for hanging out with me. It's always good to have some company. It's just me and the old man here at night. You know, we don't have any kids, so it's good to have y'all hanging around with us. So again, thanks. I love you all. And until we meet up again, you know what I'm going to say? Always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. And don't let anybody try to tell you any different, because they will try. All right, everyone. Have a good evening. Thanks again for listening. Whoa, where do you think you're going? You haven't hit that like and subscribe button yet, have you? You hear that? Yeah, that is one cranky, sassy Squatch. Please don't leave me here with him like that. Just hit that like and subscribe button if you haven't already, and it'll just calm Mr. Sassy Squatch pants over there all down. Thanks.